Hello, everybody, and welcome back. We do apologise for the minor delay. I think we are all now up and rocking and rolling, and welcome back once again to the HCS European Pro League stream. Game 3 is going to be X-Men taking on Pulse Gaming. Gentlemen, are we ready for this final matchup?
We are definitely ready for this final matchup.
As a statistician, so ready.
I'm really excited. I think X-Men have got a lot to prove here. They've got a chance to step up and kind of assert themselves as one of the top teams once again, because they were looking a little bit shaky kind of in the past few weeks.
Yeah, they really were. And I really liked the addition with Ramirez. So really looking forward to seeing how this team plays. This is our actual first look. Production is just making me laugh right now. I can't deal with this.
You see, this is like stars in your eyes from one cable to no cable. No one would have noticed, but we all heard things there.
But yeah, no, so we've got a fantastic game coming up. We'll bring the series layout up now just to remind ourselves how this one's going to play out in this best of five series. X-Men taking on Pulse Gaming will be our final series of the evening. This is a battle of two teams that are all coming off the back of several team changes. Game one will be Colosseum, Capture the Flag. Game number two will be Regret Slayer. Game number three will be Plaza Strongholds. Game four will be Fathom Capture the Flag, and if needed. And unfortunately, we've seen a few... Well, actually, not unfortunately, it's been great. We could possibly see yet another game number five. It will be the form of Plaza Slayer. But again, it's all about game number one and how we set this one off. Can Pulse start off live and kicking, or will we see the X-Men just kind of do what X-Men do and be the beast that we know and love? Collie, CTF... She's standard here. Look, she's standard players. You've got rockets. You've got snipers. A scout shot on there to boot. Get in the Royal 2 corner. Pull the flag. Full steam ahead. And honestly, Snipe Drone, Jimbo, Chalky, Ramirez, they're the kind of guys in Europe that can pull this kind of level of play off.
You should be their coach. I like those stats you just dropped.
Do you like that?
You named all the weapons and everything. Now they know. I think it's going to be a 3-0, by the way. I'm just going to throw that out there now.
Dan, you're so savage.
I think X-Men...
You don't mess around here, son.
He really doesn't.
I think X-Men are going to win this one.
Just because he knows all the big words and how to pronounce them. There's no need to pick on us little beings.
Well, I must say big words makes up for his human size as a small gentleman. But anyway, moving in. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for bearing with us. This is your final series of the night. Please tweet the stream. Use the hashtag HCS. Capture the flag on Colosseum will be our first game of the evening. X-Men taking on French team Pulse Gaming. We're going to be kicking things off with Jimbo's POV as he makes his way towards the Rockets.
Yep, and obviously the Carbine has been added to Top Rockets now, so there is definitely reason to be pushing there. Aside from the Rockets, there will usually be this 1v1 kind of contest to see who can grab those rockets, but Jimbo is taken down by Cali, and the early kind of control is going towards Pulse Gaming. But will Cali see this player pushing up to him? He has to use a suicide rocket to take down Chalky.
Well, Chalky went for a good effort. He did straight up spat and charge into him. We've got the initial one. We're going to see Ramirez poking up. He will take down SLG. The opposing team's captain will challenge one team. It was actually Fragger who comes in with a double kill. That flag's still going to be on the move. It's in the other 50% yard line. That could be a quick cap. However, they need to be careful. A snipe drone is inside the base. He gets taken down by Punisher with the flag. That, my friends, is one flag on the board straight away for Pulse Gaming. What a way to start it.
Let's clarify. I meant 3-0 in the series rather than the game. But yeah, a great start from these guys. They were able to get the rockets. They were able to get control of Sniper, and they just had a better starting strat than the X-Men did. Ramirez trying to do some work, trying to stay alive, but at the moment, he seems to be on his own. He doesn't seem to be with his teammate.
This is the kind of stat that you want, though, and these players have come straight out live and kicking off the start. Jimbo's pushing two players on his own. That's giving away an easy death. We'll see Chalky picking up a double kill as well, looking for one inside. That's going to be a triple, I do believe. Yes, it is. Looking for the over. Will he land it? I actually know. He's going to get stolen by Jimbo at the end. He does go down. Great assist, but that's going to be all four members now of Pulse Gaming down. Can they get a flag pull? No, they can't. They're already in the base. Nobody was there to extend and kind of make use of the brilliant player that Chalky just got.
Yeah, and that's the Chalky that we're used to seeing, the Chalky of old. He can kind of pull it off, and all of these X-Men players, okay, bar maybe Ramirez, are capable of doing that kind of play. They are capable of just taking down a whole team with just a battle rifle, with just a pistol. They have got such excellent skill about them, but having Ramirez just to kind of back them up, be that support player, push them in the right direction is what this X-Men squad need. I just think they lack a bit of confidence right now, so they could do with a win on the board in this series.
Snipe Drone will chase the kill and then get punished by a guy just kind of hanging around the pyramid section. Punisher now just backing off for a second. Two grenades going in, looking for any hit markers around anybody on the maze section of red. We'll drop down. We'll find one player.
No!
Oh, it almost happened. Jimmy. He didn't get away with it. Punisher gets away with murder as he lights him up with an AR. Does manage to survive for just a second. Now, I like the play here. He did back out for a second. He was letting Snipe Drone come to him and just try and get away with his own life. Didn't manage to do it. Saw it through. Jimbo now spawning straight into the red corner. We'll check the rocket street. Nobody's there. As he works his way back, gets the call out for some support and just worms his way through his own base and back over to the sniper section.
Yeah, Jimbo just trying to get some sniper control. Basically, X-Men need that sniper control, especially with Sniper coming up as well. If they're able to grab this, use it effectively, give it to Snipe Drone, allow him to just go off. That's what they need in this game. But Jimbo is going to pick it up and probably take it back towards his base. Needs to be careful that he's going to get pushed by a few of these Pulse players.
And literally the second that he picks it up, within two bullets, he's already dead. I'm looking to see who's got control of Rockets. It was Pulse Gaming with Cali. Cali will drop down the bottom section, looking for anyone to try and take back and take control of those Rockets that he did drop. Not entirely sure how many was left in there, but still, nevertheless, looking across the board, can't see anyone with control, I'm sure. We'll see it poking up on the kill feed for a second. Ramirez, though, creeping back to the base, will find Cali. He's got the wrong gun out, though. He needs to get something a bit more long range than that AR. Grenades are going in. He's going to jump out onto the Blue Bridge, and all of a sudden, we'll see Team Captain SLG coming around to try and get the collection on there. Jimbo's there for the touch, but you know what? He says no. Turns around just a second too late.
They're the kind of plays I'm expecting from Ramirez, just kind of pushing into that base, pulling out the flag, relying on his teammates to just slay, because they are very good slayers. So Ramirez just has to kind of take it on the chin that he is going to probably be the objective player, but he is up. I was up top for the Rockets, but he gets the triple kill. Fantastic from Ramirez. I said that all of his teammates were fantastic at kind of getting these multi-kills, and maybe Ramirez wasn't, but he's proving that he can hang with the big dogs as well.
Whips out the SMG, one player goes for the ground pound. That would have been his overkill had he not have backed off. His teammate was there for support. Now he's in a great place, so he just needs to anchor and kind of lock down. Unfortunately, he will not be able to lock down the sniper section. Fragger is here with the Rockets, finds Chalky, gives him one to the jawline. He's got one in the chamber. Just note to the left-hand side, there's somebody out on the outside wing just camping there. That's going to go in. Just clips Jimbo. Snipe comes in. I'm guessing that's from across map. It is. We can see on the player outlines. We've got SLG over in his own base, just sniping across map.
I'm really loving what I'm seeing at Pulse so far in this game. They're 1-0 up, and every single time X-Men try and push in for a flag capture, they're always, always ready to kill the player about to pull the flag from their own base. Pulse doing a great job stopping the run early from X-Men. They clearly know exactly what Ramirez wants to do every single time. Run in, pull the flag when they are too dead, but Pulse able to stop him most of the time so far, halfway through this game.
Now, Ramirez is constantly contesting that kind of rocket side of the map. It was a shame he dropped down. He did get the triple earlier, but he gave up that rocket control to Pulse Gaming. If perhaps he had kept those rockets, there might have been a chance, as we do see Chalky pushing in. Doesn't quite get the triple kill because Jimbo is there to finish things off, but this is the flag run that we needed. They've got the map control, they know where they're spawning. Now the X-Men players need to support Chalky in running this flag in.
Jimbo did trade in that corner, and that was quite an important and key kill because that stopped them from actually advancing on Chalky down the sniper side. So great trade-off from Jimbo over in Blue Cave. We see Chalky now coming straight, turn around, dumps the flag, and we'll put some great shots on two players hanging around on their window ledge as he goes in with the SMG, takes down one, hanging around on the DMR. He will now look for anybody spawning in the back of the base, but also coming out of the blue corner. No one there to boot as he does drop down. Snipe Drone straight off the respawn, looking around the corner, will jump out onto his outside ledge and move forward to the pyramid.
They've actually hit their stride at a pivotal point in the game right now. They didn't just pick up the sniper, but it seems like X-Men have finally woken up. They're starting to get kills on the board now. We had a great period of kills there from X-Men, and they got a flag cap off the back of it. I'm not sure who got the Rockets. In fact, X-Men who got the Rockets as well. So good stuff there from X-Men, and now they're on the board.
Punisher just going one on one with it's going to be Snipe Drone. Snipe Drone does take him down, but his teammate Captain comes back in to help him out. Jimbo making great use of the pyramid, but you know what?
Rip.
Oh yeah, he actually answered back and said no. Jimbo got sat down even though he was jumping around and had the height advantage. I think I just saw someone. Yes, we did. Jimbo's going to come straight off back of the red spawn and move towards the red cave. Down goes one. Ramirez is there. He's coming. That's a brilliant, brilliant play. There's two people just waiting. They can take down that last player. That's going to be Punisher. You can just run through, just scoop this one up and run towards his teammates waiting on Sniper.
I would have kind of liked Cali try and take that flag out of front window and just try and survive, because then he would have been able to just basically stay alive, pull that flag, and his teammates would have been able to slay around him.
Two players, though, going to take down. SLG Sniper will fall. They're all advancing. Jimbo's got a scatter shot as well, so they're not going to be able to get anywhere near that flag unless they do something very, very weird and very unorthodox. That's going to be a clean and easy return. One apiece is the scoreline. 4:30 remaining on the clock. Still neck and neck and all the work to do. It definitely, I want to say, I don't know about you, Harry, possibly. Yeah, I think we're definitely agreeing here. The kills are 110% in the hands of... Oh, Chalky, though, that put me off completely. That was a cracking perfect kill.
I mean, he got a triple-double there. I mean, Chalky is really lighting up. Just having Ramirez as the support, this duo that we've spoke about, it just allows Chalky, gives Chalky that freedom. I felt the old X-Men when they had Foxy as well. There was, like Harry said, just too many cooks. There was too many people trying to slay. No one was really doing the objective. No one was really doing the support. And I really love the addition of Ramirez. They're looking good at the moment. They're taking a while to warm up, but they've definitely got control of this match.
And Rockets is exactly where you want them to be, over on the sniper side, just stopping anybody from moving back into that base. Down goes one. You've got Snipe Drone coming in from the blue corner as well. He's going to run towards Blue Cape. They'll probably chase him, which they do. SLG will meet the blunt end of a rocket. They now need to be aware of where they're spawning. They're spawning on that rocket side. Jimbo's going to turn face. He's got one down in the basement, as we can see on the radar. He's just looking and checking that cave. Does pre-fire. Nobody's there. But two of them are in for the stop. Still one flag each down.
See, this is the kind of period of the game where Ramirez will be telling Jimbo, hey, that flag's gone. Stay in their base. Be a nuisance. You can't let them push out for free. That's exactly what Jimbo did. He stayed in the pulse base, made sure they had to come back and clean him up. I love that play, and no doubt Jimbo there got a call out of Ramirez.
I want to say that I'm surprised that this game is so close, but honestly I'm not. I mean, definitely the slaying power is 110% in the hands of X-Men, but you know, Pulse are putting on some, what about you, some cracking defense.
Sometimes this happens when you add a new player to the roster and when you're still kind of finding your feet. You don't really know how to pull those flags. You don't know where you're kind of setting up. You're still learning the trade as a team. They're still very early in their development, but they are pulling the flag. It is looking like it is going to go in. I don't think there is a Pulse member there to stop it. They will go 2-1 up with 2.5 minutes remaining.
And again, that's not much time now. The pressure really back in the hands. Another cracking shot from Chalky. Chalky's definitely moving into the Chalky of old and the one that we love and have missed for quite some time now. His shot is absolutely dominant and he's a force to be meddled with, pushing in hard here on Cali. Another perfect kill. Oh my, Chalky. What has happened to this man?
I just think that Chalky's kind of found a new life. After this transfer period, it's given X-Men another chance. They were kind of down and out. They had lost all of their confidence. But this change has just allowed Chalky to really come out of his shell. It's the Chalky we're used to seeing. His shot is on absolute fire right now.
And I've got to ask you, Dan, do you think this is because he's got, I want to call him his dad, his brother, his being at the end of the day, he's back with Ramirez. Do you think he's a lot more comfortable now?
It's definitely going to add confidence. When you know you've got that support back, when you know you've got a familiar face that you can look to if you're in trouble. Yes, okay, him and Foxy have teamed together before, but they would often find themselves on different sides of the map. But you will see Ramirez pushing with Chalky ever so often. That definitely Chalky is going to benefit from Ramirez being on this team, as we see Ramirez and Chalky duoing and taking down that Pulse member there.
That's the last guy. He's alive. He's just going to survive as he jumps down from S3 straight into grass. No angles of line of sight. Now we see Jimbo just being super, super aggressive and pushing in hard. Ramirez is out in the doorway. They could probably just pull this and just be a nuisance here just to tick the time down. 1 minute remaining on the clock. Dominant shots from Jimbo straight across. Third person just to show you where everyone's spawning. They're moving and they're pinned pretty much back down into that blue cave corner. Excuse me, not cave, just on the blue corner side as they run down from Rockets. And now they're kind of getting bottlenecked in the bottom middle section. They're going to try and get this return. Scatter shot on the flag is exactly where you want it. Cali will get that as he moves over to Andy. There's going to be Ramirez spawning in Red Cave. Now they're going to push. In theory, they actually have all the men and capabilities here to make something happen.
Yeah, Dan. Time is a massive factor right now. Only 30 seconds left in the game. Cali is making huge plays. That's a spree from him. And they're already in the base to run this flag. But Ramirez again with a big double. The new addition to X-Men really shutting down Pulse there. And I've got to say, there doesn't look like there's much more time on the clock for Pulse to move this flag across the map.
Grenades are coming in, and you kind of call it there, Harry. There's not really a lot they can do. They've got 10 seconds. It would take a miracle as Ramirez comes in. He'll stop that final flag. He'll get the return as well to boot. That is game, set, and match. X-Men put one on the board. However, I've got to say, Dan, Hulse didn't go down without a fight, and they did not make that easy. I know initially at the end there, that was a pretty damn good push. We could have seen something happen.
Kelly did fantastic work at the end there. It wasn't quite a triple, but it may as well have been. He was able to stop that flag, and then they all pushed in as a unit. Fantastic performance from Pulse, but X-Men just outslaying them, and, well, they made a game of it, so I'll give credit to Pulse there.
The Ramirez effect.
Can we all just take a minute to appreciate the 32 kills and the golden arrow that's next to his name?
Chalky's back.
Chalky is back. Getting more kills than Jimbo. 21 and 21 out of Ramirez and Snipedrone, though. When you look at, you know, and we kind of said this, Fragger, new addition to the team, 28 kills. Bang, there you go. This is why I truly believe they took down Infuse last week. I think he's a great little addition. He's a lot more firepower to this roster needed, and certainly they didn't make it easy.
In the first few weeks, Pulse were just a team that kind of rolled over and just like showed their bellies, but now it just seems like they've got a bit of fire about them, and they definitely are making matches.
It's a real shame that we don't see this Pulse like earlier on in the league. I really wish we had seen this Pulse turn up at earlier league matches. Like earlier on in the league, it just seemed like they were just letting games go, and the new addition here for X-Men pretty much shut them down the whole game. Yes, he only had 21 kills, but he was the man enabling this man right here. Chalky was just getting kills everywhere he went. He almost had another triple there, but Jimbo, it was actually a double from both Jimbo and Chalky, and there you go, the flag run. I believe that was their first flag on the board, so great execution there from X-Men, and they take game number one.
Incredible, incredible stuff. But also from their side, it's not to be doubted, Pulse Gaming put up a damn good fight. Extremely excited to get this game number two underway and see how this one pans out. We'll bring up the series layout in just a second to show you guys at home how game number one ended and what we'll be rolling into. I believe it's a regret slayer.
It is a regret slayer, and it's going to be an interesting one, that's for sure. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if we're kind of like one for one. Maybe we'll be at about 25, 24, and then one of the teams will get that top mid control. They'll really use the overshield control, and that's when you'll start to see it spiral out of control. It's similar to Truth in some aspects that it can really run. You can run away with the game on this map.
Yeah, I completely agree. And the interesting thing about this matchup in particular on this map, X-Men is the only team that have played this map in this matchup. They've played it once. They've won it, but Pulse have yet to play this in the Pro League. So between these two teams, they have one match on this map.
I think the one thing that I'm a big fan of on this map is that very, very cheeky Storm Rifle that is down where the shotgun used to be. You just go in there, you grab that thing, and especially if you've got OS as well, if you can get the OS and then beeline just to where Carbine is. Beeline to the lower Cow 1. Grab that Storm Rifle. You can cause so many problems. You can be super, because you've got that layer of OS just to kind of a little bit of leeway, charging into bases when they're spawning and just going and lay down some serious fire. And now you've got, rather than the DMRs up on the wings, you've got the BRs now. I feel there's a lot more engagements rather than just being pinned back and peppered constantly with a DMR in your face. The amount of times, even I would do it, you'd just be that guy who just stuck there and just peppered people out of windows. There's a lot more engagements now, and again, we're really seeing the plasma caster coming into its own on regret.
I really want to see Chalky just get hold of one of those battle rifles, really. And then Ramirez is the one who needs to be careful. On these Slayers, he doesn't want to try and do too much. Because, yes, he's one of those players that wants to do everything to try and win the game, but he doesn't want to get into a position where he's constantly flanking around his own and giving away needless deaths. If he pushes in, grabs that Storm Rifle, like you said, he's the kind of player you want to be grabbing that weapon, getting behind them, and just being a nuisance.
I can't tell if I think this is more of a snowballer game type than Truth. I don't know which is the lesser of the two evils between the two Slayers at the moment. Because there are two Battle Rifles on this map. Yes, there's a Storm Rifle at a bottom Carbine, which adds another element to the map. But on Truth Slayer, you have that camouflage, right? It's a bit more of a passive power-up. On this map, it's more of an aggressive power-up. It's overshield. It comes up every 2 minutes, bottom middle. And I don't know, if you can get the two battle rifles, the plasma caster and the overshield, how are you meant to break that setup? I don't know. I don't have a clue. I don't think there's a team in the world that would be able to stop
that. I think it's noticeable, and just notable to see what Batchford kind of mentioned to me once, is the walls. If you get someone up top mid, and then you learn, and then you can pretty much just force them, force spawn, because it's obviously a backwards spawn, so you go red base, blue, and backwards and forwards and such. You just get someone up on top of those walls, as we see now in the top middle section, you can rain down bullets literally into the face of your enemies, whether they go out the left side, the right side, the front side. You can just batter them with lead raining down from the sky as soon as they step foot out of that base. However, it is notable how important this first OS is.
is very important. And the main difference between obviously Truth and this map is the overshield rather than the camo. With camo, if you kind of drop down and grab that camo, you are going to die. Whereas if you grab the overshield, there's a chance you could survive even if there are three people staring at you. I think that's the main difference.
Ramirez will jump up to get the pea shooter just as kind of an answer to anyone who takes control of that first OS. I'm not entirely sure who did have the first OS. I'm
SLG across we're on board with.
SLG. Oh, it was. I do apologize. I wasn't even looking at the top for a second then. So he's going to grab that. He will fall down. Plasma Caster will come into effect from Jimbo. Jimbo's falls. 4-5 the score. Still quite a quick game straight off the back. Grenade goes in. No hit markers for Chalky. But he's in a great place. He could just sit here and slay all day if he really wanted to.
Already, X-Men have got this top mid control and the Pulse are trying to push out. It looks like they're going to try and make a move Carbine side. They are going to meet Chalky. It does look like he has got some support top mid, but the fact that Pulse pushed as a three then was fantastic. They were patient, they decided where they want to go, and they managed to take down two of the X-Men players and regain some of this map control.
And you mentioned how important top control is. Cali's on a killing spree. He's taken this with his Storm Rifle. Snipe Drone will jump up. As soon as Cali pokes around that window, though, he gets put down by three players shooting at him.
I think the silver lining there for Pulse, when they were pushing out of that hold that X-Men had on them, is that they had the lead. Yes, X-Men tied it up after they pushed out, but essentially, Pulse got map control back. They weren't turtling back inside the base. They gave up their one kill lead for map control, basically.
Yeah, and it was just the fact that they all chose to go in one direction. When you see often teams will just be like, okay, let's split up. You two go pink, I'll go carbine. It doesn't work. You really need to push together, especially when those battle rifles are on the map, when the plasma caster's on the map, and it's such easy way to kind of gain control of this map.
Here we are then with Ramirez. BR in hand does go down as SLG will try and take back and control of the blue base. They are spawning on this blue side. They're going to be moving up to the top middle section. There's several of them there. Oh, we're going to see the plasma caster is always coming into effect, so no doubt the OS will be coming up any second. They do have a very small lead. However, this OS, but look at Jimbo. That was a fantastic flank. He knew they were setting up down for the OS. He comes in. That allows Snipe Drone to just come in, bang it into his chest, and now they have control. That could be the change round of the game. What a fantastic flank by Jimbo.
That's the thing with the overshield being on the map as well. You saw all four X-Men members drop for that overshield. It means you throw away that map control to get that power up. So it does mean that Pulse could have kind of pushed top mid and gained that like top mid control. But with the overshield in hand, it does mean that you can regain it a lot easier.
I like the fact that every time we do look at some of the Pulse Gaming members, they're shooting one player and all of a sudden we hear the arrow, we hear the little ping. We do see a lot of assists coming in. That's what we need is with a team like X-Men. Ooh, that's going to be Jimbo answering back. He was one shot, did trade off with the one shot as well. Nice little shot from him to trade one back. 19-22. Snipe Drone just turtling around top mid, looking to try and take control and make something happen and bring them back in this game. One player will be moving behind him in the base. Ramirez ticking up and taking control of the Storm Rifle down below him. But here comes Cali on the left-hand side wing assault.
Yeah, it's a two-kill lead at the moment for Pulse. But you've got to think, if they were able to execute on that last overshield, how big would the lead be right now? Snipe Drone was able to get it, and now they're almost tied up. If he can finish off this kill, they will be tied up. But if Pulse had managed to get that last overshield, you've got to think, how big a lead would it have been for them right now?
It would have been extremely dangerous, and to be honest with you, they've kind of put themselves in this position now where they can answer back and they can stand up to the onslaught of X-Men. They're doing extremely well. It's a neck and neck, and I believe at this, we'll see if it plays out the same as Truth, where it gets to around the 30 mark, then things really do start to spiral out of control. At this moment, they do have the control, so Ramirez is just going to move around and force the spawns in the base, then collapse inwards. Chalky wasn't there in time, so they did run straight up that wing. However, he is one shot. They could probably clear him up and try and take back carbine control.
Ramirez is doing exactly what I said would be good for him to do. He grabbed the Storm Rifle. He's just being a nuisance. He was able to pick up a double whilst his teammates just keep control of that top, and it means Ramirez can call out wherever these Pulse guys are spawning, and it just gives so much information to the X-Men lineup. They've got a three-kill lead now. This next overshield is going to be absolutely vital.
And I think everyone knows that, because everyone's starting to really feel around that bottom mid section. They really want this one. SLG's down there. His teammates down there as well. Cali, we're just looking. Oh, he just picked it up as well. Every time I look away, is that the second or third one now that SLG may have picked up?
Yeah,
that,
I think it's the second one.
Second one, but it's interesting that SLG got the first one, X-Men got the second, and then SLG now has the third one. So back and forth here with the overshields.
It just kind of plays the story of how important they are. 30-34 is the score. We're now seeing X-Men start to make a little bit of a lead. But you know what? Pulse did have a bigger lead earlier on, and X-Men have brought it back. Punisher will challenge Chalky. He'll step back, and then Ramirez comes in out of nowhere and shuts him down. And now we're really starting to see the X-Men train come alive down. They're getting points on the board. We've got to, saying that, still only a 3-kill game at 7 minutes on the board.
The main difference is X-Men are more than happy to kind of float around bottom mid and below bases. They just need to be careful not to kind of sacrifice this map control, because if they get locked into a base, they might give a chance back to Pulse of getting back in this game. I mean, they're only 3 kills behind. They just need like a triple or someone to make a nice double. Suddenly, it flips on the other side of the coin, and this Pulse Gaming squad have definitely still got a chance in this game.
Harry, I just want to get your thoughts on this one just for a second. Obviously, you mentioned earlier on whether or not this were going to spiral out of control at a fast rate, kind of like Truth. It's neck and neck. We're only in a 1-kill game. Any initial thoughts?
Yeah, it's interesting. I think that Taylor, the Overshields, really plays into the fact that it is so close right now. And credit to Pulse as well. Although Snipe Drone was able to get the second Overshield, Pulse was able to keep it close. I think the biggest lead for X-Men at one time was around 6 kills. So credit to Pulse for keeping it close when they didn't get the Overshield. And when they get the Overshield, they seem to make it absolutely clinical.
And there's going to be a big decision now, because one of these teams is going to have map control. Overshield is going to be coming up. It's going to be, are we happy to sacrifice map control for this Overshield, because we know how vital this Overshield is going to be, as we only need 8 kills for both teams. This Overshield is going to be picked up by Ramirez. He's the man of the moment, and at the moment, he's the guy we've been talking about. He's the guy we said X-Men needed. Can he kind of pull them through the end of this game?
But you know what? There are a lot of deaths given away. I think there were possibly one or two deaths given down that bottom section as they did push forward. He's going to grab Plasma Caster as well. This weapon is absolutely on point after the update now. It does some serious amount of damage, and players now utilize it to the best of their abilities. He's going to just keep spraying in there and finally get a kill. He doesn't have any OS left. His teammate Jimbo's going to clean that up. That's 3-4, and look at that. We were up to 43-43, and now all of a sudden it's 49-43. I think that is going to be game, set, match, and just shows you how important and the amount of work. He didn't really get many kills, but how you can really push with that OS.
Yeah, it's not quite over yet, but of course only 1 kill needed. X-Men are getting very aggressive towards the end of this game, but they do need to be careful, because if Pulse can set up, they might be able to make a comeback here, and the nerves will start to settle for this X-Men squad. I'd like to see X-Men just kind of push as a 4 just to try and get that last kill now.
How incredible would it be if they managed to bring this one back? Everyone's turtling. Oh, I think Punisher's going to get caught out. Yes, he is indeed. Jimbo will jump up there. He moved into the BR section, but he had several people jumping down from Plasma Caster 2 were in the base. They just hedgehogged him into a corner, took him down, sealed the deal. But you know what? Damn good game. Absolutely a fantastic game from both sides. Fair enough, we look at the bottom. Only 5 kills for Fragger, but 14 assists. That's really helping his two teammates out with 16 each.
One thing I want to highlight here is Snipe Drone's fantastic performance. He had least deaths in the game. He had more kills than deaths. He was positive 4. And he also had 12 assists. And he had one more assist than he did kills as well. So great supportive play while staying alive there from Snipe Drone. Great job.
And Rami, top of the board. I was saying he just needed to be a nuisance. He needed to use that Storm Rifle and not get caught out. But, I mean, he's really showing up today. We said it's what X-Men needed, and they've kind of got it. They've arrived, and now they're one map away from winning the series.
Are we just saying that this is the Chalky and Ramirez effect?
Too foxy was the problem.
Hashtag, is that the new hashtag going around?
Well, think about it. He's joined U4X.
Oh, God, he's going to throw Perry under the bus.
They've dropped 2 maps, okay, and now X-Men are looking pretty good without him. So was Too Foxy the problem?
Bit Perry.
RIP the dream.
I do. I feel sorry for him, man. Feels bad. To be fair, though, that's why we've got him on the show, so we don't have to like the bad guys.
Yeah. I'll be the bad guy. We'll just keep Perry's my boy. Okay. But, you know, you've got to think, was he the problem?
You're all Southerners. You're all same. To us from beyond the wall, you're all the same. But yeah, great. I've got to say, great stuff so far from Pulse. I've got to give them a big... Compared to what they were before, these guys look like... I really want to say this. They're like a better team than Vibe. For me right now, I'd be more worried about going up against Vibe in relegation than Pulse.
Really?
Yeah.
Because okay, see, I'm on the other side.
I'm a big, don't get me wrong, I'm a big, big Septic supporter and a big Septic fan, but I think Pulse look really, really damn good.
Oh, no, so yeah, you think you'd rather
go up?
Yeah, yeah, okay, I agree with you. Sorry, yeah. I misheard what you said. I just think Pulse look stronger. Vibe don't look like they have as much desire. I think Pulse, after these changes, will be thinking, okay, let's look towards next season. What are the chances of us getting to finals? Not very likely, but let's keep learning. Let's keep progressing as teams so that we can make sure we're in next season and we win that relegation battle.
Of course, we want to see French teams. We want to see a French team in fall season. We want to see various teams in fall season. But you know what? Plaza Strongholds will be as game number three. Could this possibly be the last series of the evening? Dan, when it comes down to the vetoes, do we have any, when you boot your PC up, do we have any initial words on the veto? I mean, Harry, can you actually tell us any stats about Plaza Strongholds?
Not too much, honestly. Pulse have played Plaza Strongholds four times. They've only won it once. So they are 1-3 in Plaza Strongholds, whereas on the other side, X-Men are 2-1 on this game site. So you have to say X-Men probably favourites to take this. Overall, on Plaza, Pulse actually only have a 28% win ratio. They've only won two out of their seven games that they've played on Plaza, that's Slayer included, of course. But you've got to look, you've got to think as well. Pulse haven't taken that many maps in total in the Pro League. Considering two of them are on Plaza, maybe Plaza's their map, you never know.
I think Plaza Strongholds is everyone's map right now. It's one of the easiest maps to control spawns. Everyone's very knowledgeable of where people are spawning, what's going on, so everyone's happy to play. I think it's one of the least vetoed maps for Strongholds across the board for everyone, so pretty much everyone's confident playing it right now.
Shotgun is the key. Mark my words.
Shotgun is the key.
Shotgun is the key. Literally, just get that, stick it in your back pocket, go sit in yard, let everyone else do the work. Just like, this is me, you want a bit?
There's two kinds of people. I go for the Hydra. This guy over here, this goes for the scumbag shotgun,
Dan,
and sits in corners.
Shotgun or Hydra?
Sniper.
Sniper's not even on the map, so we'll move off from that.
Well, you completely messed it up then, did he? Under these conditions, okay.
Dan. I don't want a shotgun or a Hydra, personally. I'd rather have a sniper. Can we just replace the Hydra with a sniper? Thanks.
I don't think so.
To be fair, though, I'm a big SMG fan. There's not better than jumping down that loop, sticking that thing in your back pocket, and absolutely kicking ass. I'm a big fan. Straight away off the spawn, I'll either go two ways, especially if I'm back at yard. Depending on where my teammates are, I'll instantly go for the shotgun or straight for the SMG and then be the aggressive push from the shotgun, push down into the bottom section.
How not to play Halo 5 by Sims.
By Sims, yeah. You're talking, mate, talking to an Onyx here. Talking to an Onyx 1650.
1650, is that it?
Yeah,
I'm 1900.
Really?
Yeah, get on my level.
Diamond 1!
Oh dear. All right then, guys. This is it. This could potentially be it. This is our third game of our third series of the evening. X-Men will want to shut this one down just as quick as possible. Here we go, kicking things off with Jimbo's POV.
Yeah, and he's just going to pick up the battle rifle. It clearly, Ramirez was more than happy for Jimbo to get it, and Ramirez has in his head that he was just going to dart out. But Jimbo can't back him up and keep Ramirez alive. Ramirez was wanting to jump up and probably look towards that top mid, as Jimbo is going to take that plasma pistol just in case anyone with a power up walks past.
And this is a great place to be because you can just get eyes on the prize and look all around, which he will do. He'll jump through the air, finds Punisher bottom mid, hits him with a new combo as well. Not fast enough to turn around and get Fragger, as Fragger will drop down. Ramirez comes steamboating in with the SMG, punches one, takes two, that's the double kill, and they should turn base on this bottom mid section, but two people are running down the driveway. Grenades are coming in thick and fast. He's going to get his shields back. This weapon, I just love seeing this thing in play. It sounds good, it looks good, and my god, does it do some damage.
It definitely does, and I know SMGs were removed off a couple of the maps because they were worried they were a bit too strong, but I do still like the inclusion on this map. Not sure what happened with the camo at the start, but that's definitely something you want to keep an eye out for on this map.
No, oh, Rami, he will finally drop, but you know what, he's got a killing spree. Punisher comes in with the SMG himself and answers back with a double kill, but you know what, it's not about the kills, it's about the plots in current control, as we see Cali taking down one. SLG will move towards Nest. They'll try and look to lock this one down.
Interesting what we saw there, actually, out of the X-Men. They were doing exactly what Pulse did to Infused last week. When Infused had the yard, basically X-Men said, you know what, we're not even going to let you have the yard. We're just going to push that. X-Men did the exact same to Pulse then, but I think Pulse, a bit more well-rehearsed than Infused, they knew how to push out of that setup, and now they're capturing bottom middle, and this could be a potential triple cap right here.
But they need to really get Cali out of the S4 section, as he will drop down. Chalky doesn't chase, though. We're going to turn off this player outline just for a second. Chalky will then challenge afterwards. Cali cleans him up quite easily. Cali, been a bit of a decent anchor right now. And did I possibly just see, could be wrong here? I think.
Say the word. Camouflage?
I want to say.
No,
it.
It's not.
I think I just possibly
it's
said
not up
that
yet,
there
Sims.
Wasn't. No, I wasn't too sure. I think my eyes were seeing things. It's late. Come on, gents. Give my old man eyes a break. Another killing spree, though, for on the board. That's for second player. We've seen that one. Oh, Cali's going to miss his second beatdown. Snipedrone takes advantage of it. Snipedrone with a double and a reversal, though, with the new combo hanging around in bottom mid.
I've got to say, actually, Cali is probably my Pulse MVP right now. Every game his shot's been on absolute fire, and this game he's just, like you said, he's anchoring well, he's supporting his teammates. But I feel as soon as X-Men get that map control, the fact that they've got some the camo as well in Jimbo, it might kind of spiral out of control a little bit for Pulse, especially if they can trap them in that yard or perhaps in an alternative spawn, maybe in Cafe as well. Just the X-Men squad, they move around so well as a unit. Pulse are fairly good at breaking setups, I'll give them that, but I do think X-Men have probably got this one in the back.
Oh, Jimbo with the swipe, just sweeps it over his head and takes him down with the noob combo. I see SLG straight off the spawn though, super aggressive. He knows that Jimmy's there, so he wants a piece of him. Comes back around the corner, there's two of them in the top mid, killing. That's the third or fourth killing spree now, I've seen one from either side. Another noob combo at the moment. Jim being dominant and just controlling, absolutely controlling this back 50% of the map on his own.
This right here, when they have the triple cap, they need to try and keep it. Put pressure on those players trying to recapture the yard to stop the bleeding. I think that's exactly what's happening right now. Yes, a couple of the X-Men players go down, but check it out. SLG spawned in blue. He has to go back to yard, and Jimbo is already aware of that. Great awareness there from Jimbo. Yes, they'll lose the yard, but they still have total map control. They have bottom middle. They have the nest. They don't need to worry about the yard just yet.
Well, things are starting to escalate just a little bit quickly. You mentioned Cali being that key player who will give Jimbo a nice 1-2-3-4 hot five to the face. Punisher comes flying around the corner. SMG in hand. Ramirez, good night. They're going to try and turn this nest. However, there's one. There's two. There's two more players down that bottom section. Shotguns in hand. There's the double kill for Cali. Triple kill is running down the ramp. He's going to challenge for it, but Snipe Drone will say no.
Really important kill there from Snipe Drone. He's able to come in and reset that bottom mid as well. Just the fact they can keep bottom mid and keep the pressure on Pulse a little bit, it allows the rest of the X-Men to push out to maybe that yard and maybe to nest just to try and get a bit more of the upper ground map control.
And now there's two of them working in pairs. They're a little bit in danger. There's three of them all together. They don't want to let Jimmy get a hold of that. Otherwise, he's going to be a danger and a nuisance to that nest section. We'll see where he goes with this one as the 2-2 turn face on bottom mid. SLG comes flying down. He's going to hide behind White Cow, but you can get a shot on the leg underneath there. He'll run into Hotel. He will stay alive. And then Cali tries to get him bottom mid once again. And to be honest with you, it seems to be a little bit of a tug of war between the bottom mid sex.
It is, and X-Men are just keeping this nice and fast paced, not giving Pulse a chance to really set up. We've seen X-Men set up once, they gained about a 30-point lead because of it, and now we're just seeing this back and forth, which is just going to favour X-Men, because the longer it just stays as a back and forth and a lack of setups, they're just going to get closer and closer to that victory.
Ooh, I thought Ramirez was going to challenge it. He did poke out on one shot, unfortunately didn't manage to land the kill. Cali with Harry's favourite weapon just hanging around. What kind of guy? What kind of man hangs around in bottom mid with a Hydra?
My kind of guy.
That kind of guy. Cali right now will take down one. He'll manage to get a bit of a defense off on there. They'll stick some more points in the bag. Just crouching around. We'll scope in on the nest. Tags Jimmy up though. He can now whip out his Magnum and go after him. But you know what? Uncle Ramirez comes in with the SMG once again, every single time, Dan.
Yeah, and Pulse just still haven't set up yet. They keep pushing out for Nest, they keep pushing out for Yard, but X-Men have just had general control. They just keep pushing towards that bottom mid first, and then pushing out towards Nest. And they're just keeping Pulse on the back foot. They're just keeping control of the animal that is the French Pulse team.
And that is all fall down. We just saw 1, 2, 3, 4. Fair enough, they're all coming off the respawn. Snipe Drone's going to be super aggressive. When we look across the board, how spread out they are. We've got two in Cafe, one poking on Yard. He's going to come in for the defensive side. There's one. Punisher wants the double. He's going to chase him. Beatdown comes in, but he doesn't manage to land it. That's a brilliant play from him just to secure that Yard section.
You saw Ramirez was just in there, and he's there again, just being a nuisance in Yard, and Pulse are having to go back to that Yard to try and contest Ramirez. He's going to take the Yard. It allows them to keep scoring despite the fact that Pulse have pushed out and managed to grab Nest.
Every single time we look at that kill feed, X-Men are absolutely on fire. Two of them, the duo that is, Ramirez and Chalky, will dive bomb into it just to defend it side by side. SMG's in hand, looking towards this Nest now. Down goes one. Jimbo's getting shot and tagged up from behind. Down he goes as well. 89 points on the board. They're about to hit 90, which they do indeed. Key kill though to keep Chalky out of that one. They can maybe try and get the bottom mid and put a couple more points on the board. They might be able to hit the 50 point club. They do indeed. But you know what, Dan, that is a very fragile lead.
It is a fragile lead. Yeah, well, I mean, they only need 8 points now, and Pulse have got to just play absolutely perfectly now. But Ramirez doing Ramirez things, being an absolute nuisance, bottom mid, staying alive. If his teammates can come and support him, they might be able to get this bottom mid. But Pulse do get the reset. Punisher gets the double. not quite going to get the triple, but does take down Snipe Drone. Now, this is the point. Lock them in yard, get them on the spawn trap. You can still win this game.
And of course, this is the thing about strongholds. It's very rubber band. We've seen it before. It can happen again. The amount of comebacks when you've been in the 90-point section are very, very real.
It's deja vu for me right here. We saw this comeback before. We saw them last week against Infused. Can it happen again? Pulse have been here before. They should know how to play this. Can X-Men counter it? They know how they have to slay some of the X-Men, and then they have to push into the yard to keep the pressure up. SLG's already there capturing the yard. They might lose the nest. In fact, no, there's a play going up to S4. So in fact, it's just total control now for Pulse. And now, somehow, X-Men have to stop the bleeding.
Ramirez is in a really bad position, though. He's no shields. As the grenade comes in, he will go down. Snipe Drone's there to try and turn face on nest. They need to be super aggressive and really push out here, which is exactly what they've done. They've spawned out in yard because Pulse Gaming were nowhere near here. They've pretty much just rolling over and give them the yard section. That's two plots back in the hand. You know what? They're coming back off the spawn, though. They're answering back. But they're going to have to be quick. They're literally just going to have to dive bomb straight down the driveway, which they do. They've got the reset once again. Dan, this is getting very close to coming down to the wire.
It is getting close. I was going to say, I didn't really like the push into yard by Pulse. It kind of gave this X-Men lineup a chance back in the game, but they've managed to regain control and managed to get, I think, another triple cap right at the end of the game. This could be a fantastic comeback, Sims.
90-point club is real. They're only 5 points behind. Seeing two players blocked down in, yeah, this isn't great. They need to push out and they really need to move away. SLG put some great shots on Snipe Drone. You can't get too close to him, though. They know. They absolutely know he's got the shotgun in hand. They're about to take the lead. However, they're getting stuck up and tagged up in bottom mid down. Two goal, that's a huge kill from them. Third person comes down, he's going to challenge face. That's going to be Fragger. What a massive kill from him to stay alive. He just needs a little bit more help. He'll steam pile. Oh my word, he gets the trade. My god, Pulse Gaming come back. What a brilliant kill right at the end. They got the win. How did they get that?
Deja vu, Pulse Gaming, Plaza Strongholds. I think we found your map. Punisher, 25 kills, 9 captures. Wow, what a comeback from Pulse.
Who got that last kill? Who got it?
Punisher.
I'm pretty sure
what
it was Punisher.
A wild
Welcome
trade
to
off
the
that
Pro
one.
League.
Oh
Punisher.
My god, what a way to set the night on fire. 25 kills. Holy hell. That is Pulse Gaming at his finest. Incredible stuff.
I mean, didn't I say it? It's deja vu. I said it when they were down by around 50 points. They've been here before. They know how to counteract this push from X-Men. It was just fantastic. They had Ness and they had bottom middle. They knew they could just rest on those two strongholds. It feels like deja vu. I said this last week against Infused. They pushed into yard. They captured yard. They kept the pressure on X-Men, and by the time X-Men knew anything about it, it was game over.
It was that triple cap, though, wasn't it? Did that triple cap really give them, really brought them back into the game? But I thought it was going to be all over because I think, do we see 6 players die in 2 seconds, I would say, in bottom mid?
It was a lot, yeah. It was a mad scramble.
It was just a mad, mad rush, but wow.
It was Punisher running from garbage truck. Snipe Drone was looking the other way, and Punisher was able to get to an angle where he could take down Snipe Drone. Crouch, hide. Chalky obviously tried to get the kill, but Punisher was able to get that melee trade and won the game for them. If he were to die, if he was to die to Snipe Drone, they probably would have lost that game.
We've had some great games tonight, boys. I'm liking these changes.
Yeah.
The changes have shaken up the league, and I'm liking it.
This is the... Well, saying that, my bedtime doesn't like it, but I like it as a whole because, yeah, everyone's feeling a lot more closer now and a lot more tighter games. We've seen 2 best of 5s go all the way out. We're now moving absolutely into a game. But you know what? If this goes to a game 5, I'm blaming you.
Keep an eye on the score, though, on these replays, because I just want to know how far down Pulse Gaming really were. I mean, check it out. They're down by around 40 now. They finally get control right there. But wow, I just can't believe how much they came back from. Check it out. 30, they're down, and X-Men still have control at this point. This is crazy. I'm pretty sure X-Men went all the way up to 90 at this point. And this is the end. This is Snipe Drone getting the kill. He finally goes down, but then that play from Punisher at the end sealed the game. I just can't believe it. Pulse honestly, are just the comeback kings.
Strong. A lot of people I've seen in the past, like saying, you know, King of the Hill, we miss King of the Hill. Stronghold is a fantastic, it's one of the best and my favorite game types in Halo 5. It is truly, truly incredible. If you don't play it properly and your teamwork goes flying out the window, it can be so, so rubber band. The amount of times, even I've, you know, in matchmaking, I've been on 99 points.
I mean, even you.
I've been on 99 points before, and I've lost games of Stronghold when they've been down. People can take advantage of you if you don't, you know, get your act together and get your stuff together. You're going to lose games.
It's because you can get desperate for those last few points sometimes. So you make just irrational pushes and you don't really consider about what you're doing.
Game number 4, Fathom Capture the Flag. X-Men haven't won in the Pro League. Pulse have taken this game type off of U4X.
Really?
Yes.
That's impressive. So this is I didn't know that. I knew obviously they'd taken one. So this was the. Do you know what the score was at all for that?
I could find out for you if you give me around 5 seconds.
I'll let you look into that one when we find out what the actual score was on that one. See if it was a tight game or whether it was a whitewash. What are you doing this for?
3-1. 3-1.
So it was a decent score deficit, and at least it wasn't
a line for Pulse. We can.
Incredible stuff. Guys, ladies and gentlemen, I'll let these two argue it out. Make sure you tweet the stream. Use the hashtag HCS. This is the longest we've ever run. We've got some incredible games so far. We've seen 2 best of fives go all the way to game 5. We're now moving into a game number 4. Could, and it's certainly not impossible, could we see Pulse do the reverse sweep?
I believe anything now after what I've just seen.
We've seen anything. You believe in memes because memes are the dreams, boys, I'm telling you. The meme team, I've learned wisely from the words of wisdom of Sneaky Walrus of what he says in his stream. Ladies and gentlemen, this could be the final series, or we could be moving into yet another game number 5. Make sure to tweet the stream. Use the hashtag HitCS. Get involved in social. We have had some cracking games of European Halo esports. Right now, moving straight on board with the man, the myth, the legend, Punisher, who just put up an impressive 25 kills in the previous game.
He's just sitting back in the base. He's just going to try and secure that railgun, keep eyes on it. He knows that no one's picked it up yet because the green icon is still there, but he does see Jimbo picking it up. If he can take him down, this will be big. Good shots there from Punisher. He now needs to communicate with his team that the railgun is down. He turns around, finds Ramirez with the camo, gets the perfect on him. He's just taking down 2 of the most important things on the map.
No, oh, he did it again.
Word. Punisher is on fire right now. From last game, what did he have? 25, 28 kills, something like that. He just took down Railgun and then took down Camo with a perfect and then just came back with a last shot medal as well. This man right now is lighting up the league.
I would not, and I do mean I would not like to go toe-to-toe with these guys on a good day, especially if they do get into relegation. Whoever faces Deeds in relegation is going to be in a lot of trouble because this team right now is absolutely looking crispy. Killing spree now for Punisher, laying down some great shots, looking for Jimbo inside the base. He knows he's there, seen the shots. Here comes the one-on-one battle. Jimbo's just going to creep down. Grenades are going to come flying in. Nobody obviously had the gen spawn, so they're going to be spawning in gen and at VAT. And in the meantime, while all this is going down, we have to notice, guys, the flag's on the move, and it's also in the base of X-Men. They've just completely whipped out. However, someone's actually just go down. There's nobody there to recover it. Jimbo's going to go steamboating back, and there you have it. X-Men put 1 point in the back.
Yeah, whilst all the fighting was taking place, Ramirez said, well, I'm just going to walk into your flag, and I'm going to take it. He got it all the way back to his base. He was eventually taken down, but Jimbo was there to clean things up. And now X-Men, this is the thing. They need to just keep that momentum they had from the first 2 games. Not worry, not dwell too much on the last game. Yes, okay, they probably had it in the bag. Probably threw it away. They just need to forget that, and then they can just move on to this game.
I'm so happy these guys are doing as well as what they are. They are literally putting France on the board and just making France proud. We wanted a French team in Pro League. We got it, and this is why. Never, ever underestimate the French.
The railgun's up right now, which means camo's coming up very, very soon. So look for both teams to try and get to that top middle area. Wouldn't be surprised to see Snipe Drone here. Oh, try and get to top middle. But it seems like there's already a Pulse player, not only with the railgun, but also another player up there on top middle. So I'm going to keep my eye out for the camouflage for now. We're going to stay on board with Cali as his team are 1-0 down and he has a railgun to play with.
Just look at Jim on the outlines. He's just lying up the GPK, waiting for anyone else who wants to come around the corner. No hit markers were made. We got Punisher running. They're coming off of that bat spawn. No doubt he will get in those call-outs. He's going to try and make his way to top mid, unfortunately. Doesn't get up there in time. That's a massive kill, because not only have they taken the real gun out of play, they've also stopped a power play position for Pulse Gaming. If they would have had a hold of that and control of that, this would definitely have not have even got close. But it kind of is now, because it's allowing 2 people. It's going to be Snipe Drone and Chalky as well. They're advancing on the base, but you know what, Dan? That's another cap in the bag, and this time on the board for Pulse Gaming.
Yeah, in theory it was a stealth cap as well, because no one had got eyeline on that flag. like you said, it was really important that X-Men took down that railgun, but it meant that Chalky had to sit back on that silo and he had to take a decision to try and get the railgun guy killed. It just allowed that Pulse team to move that flag even further and further.
Here lies SLG. What the hell did Snipedrone just do to
rest
him?
Rest in peace, that sweet
was,
prince.
That was, that was disgusting. Snipedrone with the dodge of the century, but you know what? That is another flag on the move. He's moving forward with Fragzy. He's going to push down into the courtyard. He's got some support. Needs to be careful of that guy. That's going to be Jimbo come straight out of the treehouse. The flag's in the base, though. They've got one. They've got two. They've got three members. This should be a cap. He's steamboating in. Pulse have got another one on the board, Dan. It's really kicking off and heating up. This game is electrifying right now.
It's happening. And it's scaring me. And at the moment, the thing is, it's going to be the thoughts that's going through these players' head. Oh, we might tie this series 2-2. What if we lose this series? What does that say about us as players? Are we even going to make finals? Because you've got to be made aware that if, for example, X-Men were to lose the rest of their games, that they could find themselves in relegation. Pulse aren't in relegation yet. They could win every game that is left. They're looking hot right now. X-Men need to respond. Getting the camo would be important, but did Snipedrone just miss camo, or did one of his teammates pick it up?
It was one of his teammates, actually. Let's scroll through the players. It's Jimbo, who had that Predator combo, that Railgun camo, and check out the cheeky jumps he can do with it as well. So I completely respect Snipedrone there. He obviously got the call. I'm sure he would have liked a camouflage to play with, but that is absolutely not how you want to use the camouflage, boys.
He gets taken down as Snipedrone sees off two big kills for him there as he does answer back. But unfortunately, as you mentioned, Harry, camo and railgun to boot in hand. 7 minutes on the clock, 2-1. You don't want to be going down like that. And all of a sudden,
let's camp for 7 minutes,
everything's
boys.
Just
got this.
Really quiet, hasn't it? Oh, what? Okay. Never mind. He did get it after a second. He needs to be careful. He's got one in front, one behind. Ramirez will throw down a tangerine. He'll walk straight onto it. But oh my word, Snipedrone is in a bleeding beautiful position right now. That's one looking for the third. Does go down. It's got a mate coming off of the VAT spawn, so they need to be extremely careful, but they've got the flag all the way.
They have got the flag all the way, and we're going to see a little bit of a flag standoff now, which is actually probably going to benefit Pulse, because they're more than happy to just sit back and defend this one for as long as they can. Just delay the game as much as possible right now. But X-Men are on the push as Ramirez is going to push into the flag. He's going to try and get this return. He will get Spartan charged and taken down, but the return is made as Snipedrone was there. Is there anyone on the other hand to put that flag in? Yes, there is. That is 2-2. We are going down to the wire.
I think we just need to take a moment to appreciate how great of a player that was from Snipedrone. He saw what was going on. He literally just steamboated an absolute beeline into the base. As we can see on the third, there's deaths going down all across. Unfortunately, he's just walked into a wall of X-Men. There are two players going down on either side.
Oh my word.
He wilt. They really want this flag back. The flag's been moved in the opposing side. It is coming out of the corner. It's up to Fraga to pull another one, which he does. He's going to run it straight into Treehouse, but needs to be careful because X... Ooh, that's not what you want to do. Catching it again, that gives X-Men tack. He went for it. Tried to do it, and that would have been impressive if he did. But it was a little bit unlucky. And there you have it, guys. In the meantime of all that commotion, X-Men put the third and final flag of the evening in. We won't be getting a game number 5, but what an incredible game all.
I was going to say, Pulse just needed to be careful. They were pulling flags like left, right, and center, and it just allowed X-Men to get on that counter cap. They were getting outslayed. They tried to be the aggressor. They tried to pull the flag, but unfortunately, it didn't pay off.
19 kills from Snipedrone. Great performance out of him. All three caps actually coming from Jimbo. Few small mistakes here and there from X-Men. Maybe a few misuses of camouflage. Could have used a few of the power weapons a little bit better, maybe. But then we saw Snipedrone when it really mattered most. He had that railgun. He hit those two absolutely vital shots and was able to get the flag return. I believe that was for the second capture for X-Men. And they get a win on the board. Pulse, I'm afraid, I do believe that confirms their fate. They are now relegated.
And I just kind of want to say, and obviously, fair enough, they are in relegation, but it doesn't really tell the story of that
loss. Doesn't
mean
they're relegated. I let me amend my words. They're in relegation.
In relegation.
They're not relegated yet.
But when we look at that, I still think if Snipedrone hadn't have gone off like he just did, I genuinely think we'll be seeing a game 5. Snipedrone just really saved the day then for X-Men and really, really pushed them towards a key victory, which they kind of needed. But honestly, I don't think in any way, shape or form, Pulse Gaming should be disappointed. They've got this new roster. It's electrifying. It's truly, truly incredible. And right there, this is the player from Snipedrone. He got stuck in the base. He survived. He went down and dropped down Little Door, stayed alive, came back and managed to just get get the return, which caused all this chaos coming on with the flags. That was an initial bump there that we saw. He dropped it into the wall, it clipped, and allowed X-Men to kind of come back for a second. But yeah, moving into relegation, I'd actually be really scared of playing Pulse Gaming.
Yeah, I think Pulse have this team that they will just be like, look, okay, now we'll focus on this. Now we just focus on building. They just need to go from strength to strength. They've only been a team for, what, a week, if not less? So now there is their chance to learn. They've got fantastic teams to play against in the Pro League, so they've got a good chance to develop as a squad.
Yeah, that's an interesting point that you raised. They still have a few games left in the Pro League. They have like three series against other top tier competition. They can use that now to their advantage. They know, hey, a win doesn't really mean too much for us. Let's just use it as a learning experience. Let's make sure we're so solid that we're in the league next season, and then we just have to go again, because they did look really good. You know, ever since they made the change, ever since, you know, Solar stepped down, they've looked like a completely different Pulse Gaming. It's not the Pulse Gaming we saw in the first couple of weeks of the Pro League. It's a shame we didn't see this team from the start, in all honesty, because I really feel like Pulse could be up there with the other Pro League teams. But again, you've got to ask, is that just the fact that the Pro League is pretty much a shark tank right now, and the fact that anyone can take games off anyone? It just so happens that Pulse had a bit of a turbulent time. Who knows?
Do you think this is, and I'll leave this one with you, Dan, do you think this is just teams finding the feet with these changes, or do we generally believe that the Pro League just got a hell of a lot better and a lot more even?
I think it's teams finding their feet. I think they're really... I mean, the Pro League is better. Don't get me wrong. We just saw two best of fives and then a game four as well. It's definitely closely contested now. I think going into tomorrow's games and next week, we'll start to see these teams grow. We'll start to see X-Men develop. We'll start to see U4X develop. And by finals, we're going to have four really strong teams.
And of course, everything changes when we're here live at ESL's UK's Studio One in the heart of Leicester. When we kick up the LAN servers, of course, everything becomes a different ballgame. We're out of people's comfort zones. It's just everything changes when you come to LAN. People's perceptions, people's feelings, more than all, what people are happy with at home, in the bedrooms, in their safe zones. You've got to be up there on a main stage playing for a hell of a lot of money. And again, just there's a lot on the line.
You know what worries me in the fact that we've learnt today? Is U4X brought into Foxy, I assume, to be a bit more solid at live events. I think I believed more in the old U4X live event than I did today. We still have another couple of weeks of the Pro League. Obviously, we have tomorrow's matches. They have a whole week to scrim and practice and grind. And then I'm going to reserve judgment, I think, until next week. But for now, I'm not too convinced that U4X's change has actually come off in the way that they intended. Right away, anyway.
Why?
I don't know. I just think the old team was just so perfectly... They had the perfect balance of aggressive slayers in Mose and Respectful, a kind of supportive player who knows how to time power-ups and power weapons in Kimbo, and then you had Snakey, who would just do whatever it took to win. He didn't mind being bottom of the board. With this team, I'm not sure who fills in Snakey's role now. I just don't really know who slides into that role of, you know, doing whatever it takes to win. I don't know. Again, I'm going to reserve judgment until next week, until I, you know what I really think about them at a live event, or what I expect for them coming into a live event. But for now, I honestly preferred the U4X team with Snakey. But again, we have another week.
I think the important thing going into a live event, and Brandon Respectful touched on it during his interview, he was kind of leading the charge. He was calling the shots. Going into a live event, I'd rather have Too Foxy calling the shots than Respectful. No offense to Respectful, fantastic player, but has had some disastrous LAN events, and you want that kind of experience to Foxy to kind of lead the charge for you.
All right then, guys, we do have an interview. I believe we have Pulse Gaming's team captain SLG on the line. Norwin, can you hear us?
Hi. Yeah.
Hey Norwin, how's things going?
Well, not too good, I admit, because, you know, we lost 3-1 during this series.
But I've got to say, from what we've seen at the start of the Pro League to moving forward, I mean, honestly, as a team captain, I'd be very proud, because Pulse Gaming looks completely different to what it did on day number one. I don't know if you agree with that as well.
Yeah, I agree, because we changed two of our players because there were, you know, there is kind of a lack of motivation to play there. So with those two new guys, well, it's working way better. At least, like, we really want to improve and do something good.
And you guys have almost mathematically now you are in the relegation zone and you can't really fight your way out of it. Do you think as a team now you are just going to be looking at that open bracket and looking and researching at your opponents?
Yes, for sure, because like we want to maintain our place there in relegation. In Pro League actually. And obviously we're gonna, you know, try to see which of the team we're gonna play against, and do our best to stay in the league.
Noren, following in from Dan's question, you have a couple more games. You have 3 games left in the Pro League. How important is it for you as a team to learn and improve from those games?
Well, I'm not sure to reply to this question. Like, it's always important to learn from our games, and yeah, of course we're gonna try to learn like the best we can from those games. Try to win at least two games from the 3 remaining.
So obviously now I've got to say this, Norwin. So far we wanted a French roster in Pro League, and honestly we got it. We saw a bit of a shaky start. You're putting on a fantastic show for us now. We saw you guys take the initial game off U4X. We then saw you beat Infuse. We've now seen you almost push a game 5. And it was, you know, you've put up a damn good fight. And I know you're going to be disappointed with the loss, but I certainly don't think you should be disappointed as a team, because you are getting better from strength to strength. And I think I speak for us all here in saying, from a French roster, you are definitely doing the French community justice. In terms of, like, your scrimming and stuff, when you scrim, are you scrimming the guys in Pro League, or are you still focusing, because of kind of the community and stuff, do you still play against the French rosters over there, or are you focusing on scrimming against the Pro League guys now?
Well, actually we never used to scrim against French teams. Like, since the beginning of LO5 we try to focus scrimming like some EU teams. We usually scrim U4X, because they're a friend of mine, so we can easily get to scrim from there. And we always scrim EU team, like Infuse and U4X are our main scrims.
All right then, Noren, I know it's late over in France, so I want to say thank you for sticking out today, and also thank you for joining us on the interview. Wish you the best of luck once down in those relegation matches, and obviously hope to see you and the rest of the team in fall season, my friend.
Yeah, thanks, man.
See you Bye. Later.
Je t'aime, Noren.
Pardon?
Je t'aime. It means I love Noren. I love you, Noren. Something like that. I don't know.
I don't know a lot of German. But sorry.
It's a troll. He didn't like my question.
Pardon?
He didn't like my question.
It was just... No, he... It was said, a bit I don't know how question. To answer it.
To
and
be
then
fair,
he answered it.
You stole my question. So, oh, yeah. Okay. You know, blame Dan.
Okay.
Hashtag blame Dan.
To be fair, all these upsets are your fault.
They are.
It's literally... When you've got... It's like, you know, they always say... Leprechauns are lucky. Well, hobbits are unlucky.
So basically, it's your fault for making the league entertaining.
Yes, that's a good thing. Yeah. Thanks.
I defended you early on.
Yeah.
And now you throw me under the bus.
Well, and you called us both hobbits, so we're now coming back and fighting. Yeah. Against
to be fair,
you.
When you're against a northern giant, it's kind of
true.
You know, I'm going to throw myself under there as well. Anyway, fantastic games tonight. I want to say thank you to everybody around the world that has joined us. It has been truly, truly incredible. 2 game fives, 1 game 4 that could have had every potential to go to yet another game 5. I think I speak for us all when I say been fantastic. The transfer period has certainly done damage in both negative and positive ways. I think initially they're all positive, but over time, you mentioned it earlier, we get these couple of weeks going on. We've still got 3 whole play dates over here in Europe. Anything can happen. Play dates, do you like that?
Yeah, it's nice. Makes it sound like we're in a little sandbox, like playing with toys. And we commentate it.
There will be a caster's position opening up for fall season here on the desk. Look at that face.
I would like to extend a formal apology to Mr. Richard Sims. I was wrong.
Oh, this is why it's great. I absolutely love casting with these two and wouldn't have it any other way. It's fantastic banter. We hope you guys also at home do certainly enjoy it. After today's differences and all the matches that we've seen, let's take a look at how the scoreboards actually act. We'll see a couple, I think possibly somebody change places. Nope, we don't. It's exactly the same. I stand completely and utterly corrected. U4X up at the top with a big lucky 7-0. I can see that definitely being a 10-0. I've just got this feeling. Down in second, 4-3, just below them on map win percentage by only 2%. It is the X-Men. And moving down to fourth place, we have Dinosaurs on a 44%.
I tell you what, Pulse actually aren't quite out of it yet. In theory, Dinosaurs could still be 3-6, and Pulse could win both of their games to be on 3-6 as well.
Interesting.
So what you've been telling is you've been feeding us wrong information. It's all in downtown.
I made that up. Dan didn't feed me any information.
I'm only joking.
I just try and...
But there is a silver lining there for Pulse. I think it might involve actually beating Dinosaurs. Mm. Don't quote me on that. But Pulse, Vibe definitely tomorrow are facing U4X and could be staring down the barrel of 2-6. If Dinosaurs were to win as well, then that's when things are looking
bad. And if U4X beat Vibe tomorrow, they guarantee a spot at finals. I'm pretty sure they're already in finals.
U4X already
they're already guaranteed at finals, but they pretty much, at 8-0, make themselves impossible to catch, if I'm not wrong.
I still think definitely Pulse Gaming's very dangerous, even in relegation. If they play like that, I still think they're locked and loaded for fall season. I don't think they've got any problems whatsoever. Vibe in itself, it's still a damn good roster. It doesn't matter what way you look at it. As an open circuit team coming up, I'd still be concerned about fighting for Vibe because it's a bloody good roster. At the end of the day, when you look at the players on there, let's take a look at our day two games that are going to go off. Of course, these will be not only on player streams, but over on Onset's community cast. Game one will be Pulse Gaming versus Dinosaurs. Da-da-da-da-da-da. There it is. Infused versus X-Men. That'll be a really good game, especially if both teams play as they have done this evening. And Vibe versus U4X. U4X will just want to send, of course, that's some old teammates there. Robbie facing his old Dignitas teammates in the form of Respectful and Moze. It should be a U4X win, especially if Vibe don't have a great set of games as they did this evening, but a fantastic lineup for tomorrow's matches. Let's take a look at next week's schedule. Live here from ESL UK Studio 1 on Thursday, Pulse Gaming versus Vibe. That could be a very, very good game.
It's basically the wooden spoon match. the bottom two teams facing off against each other, but yeah, that's a mouth-watering matchup, actually.
Infused, get another go at U4X, and X-Men will take on Dinosaurs. Now
we get to see it.
Yes, this is the reversal sweeps. Obviously, this is, which we didn't get to see last time, this was off stream, the old Epsilon going up against one another, Snipe Drone and Jimbo versus the Buck Twins and their coach.
That's my match of the week.
Yeah,
I know HCS, you know, only care about like NA stuff, but that is my match of the week for EU. Heard it here first.
Drops the mic. And there you have it then, guys. That is all done from here at the Casters booth. I want to say thank you for everyone joining us around the world. It has been an absolute pleasure. From myself and the team here on the desk and the back, we're going to leave you with the top five. Thank you. Good night. Does get cleaned up. Now, it's always great to get someone out of the top middle section, which is where he was, because up here where Camo spawns is a power position. 57 quick scopes in. We'll grab that one shot. Perfect kill. Triple kill. What a shot from 57.
He goes top middle. He finds the second kill. Great listening. And then these shots right here on Lunny. Absolutely fantastic.
Get wrecked, Lunny.
It's a big... Another big play from him. He's been here for quite some time now.
Yep, and we just saw L-Town taken down for that overshield. I'm not sure if any player was able to get away with it. A big double kill out of Mikwin, going for the challenge here. Snipe down and gets the triple kill. Perfect out of Mikwin. Unbelievable shots. The BR clearly doing more damage than the pistol.
There it is, in the hands of Strafe.
Storm's born, I think. I don't think anyone picked it up.
It looks like Renegades is thinking people are going for it, but Optic Gaming says, no, we're not going to go for it.
I don't know how that happened, but that was beautiful.
That was awesome. Did they give him the triple? They gave him the triple. That was dirty. If there's any chance of them bringing this game back, it starts with that.
That was nice.
staying alive there.
Yeah, you can't say enough about that. It just buys your team so much time when you're able to stay alive in a situation like that.
That was almost the second back-to-back 2v1 situation where Ace came out on top, so great plays by him. But Predevenator, cancer's back.
No scope. I was about to say that new sniper had just spawned. Ends up challenging and winning that challenge against Ace, connecting with another no scope here. You have to think that Allegiance, still without that flagpole.
Optic Gaming has controlled it ever since that point in time. So new sniper going up, and another Blaine by Straight Sick. Predevenator, he's getting what he put on Optic Gaming last game, and Straight
Sick connects with both no scopes. I was about to say, I'd like to see him play selfishly here. Ends up connecting with another shot.
Looks like it goes through his legs on that one, but Goofy, can he stay alive up here? Straight's a great job just dropping down, staying alive, just waiting for help. And he hits it
off, connecting
again
with a no-scope on the rocket guy. Unbelievable. I mean, you can't say enough about staying alive there, but to connect with a no-scope at that angle is insane.